both really like birds, and that's sort of the main aim, was to get birds in first, and then we got interested in the possums and all the animals that we could possibly attract to the space.
Anne and Tom Rain live on a 4.5 hectare property at Wombourville on the New South Wales Central Coast, and they've developed an Australian garden that's a haven for local reptiles, marsupials, frogs and about 40 different species of birds.
We purchased the property because we love the trees, and as we built the house and grew the garden, we got more and more enthusiastic about trying to take advantage of the environment and build on the bush and make the garden blend in with it all.
We also make a point of if a branch comes down, we don't use it for firewood if it's out in the bush. It stays there and that becomes...
Hopefully habitat.
Habitat. The garden around the house also is pointed to habitat, encouraging our native animals and birds.
So how much have you planted?
Easily 3,000 plants. Not all of them have survived. That takes a little bit of trial and error.
It's also the more you plant, the more things do better, and that encourages it to keep going.
The trick to creating a garden like Tom and Anne's is selecting the right blend of species. Things like these native grasses provide seed for the birds, as well as cover for animals to run around in the garden. Spectacular plants like this yellow grevillea are great for nectar-feeding birds, things like the honeyeaters, lorikeets and other parrots. But another integral feature are spiky leaf plants, things like grevilleas, some of the acacias and hakeas. They provide protection from predators. Just beyond the house is an old horse paddock, which is being regenerated with local indigenous bushland species, like this rather vicious Acacia oxycedrus, which is going to provide a great habitat for the local marsupials, things like echidnas, wallabies and bandicoots. A little bit further on is a majestic blue gum forest, from which Tom and Anne have removed vast quantities of lantana and privet. This has encouraged the native plant species, which in turn has brought the wildlife back and is now attracting it into the garden.
They can move from there to there, they can breed, they're safe. It's basically safety for little animals. That's the protection we try to give them.
So the birds too, you must get a lot of birds passing through.
It's very pleasant sitting out here with the sounds of the birds.
So the galahs are quite a dominant sort of...
Galahs are a bit dominant at the moment.
Oh yeah, but the noisiest and the most beautiful thing is the yellow-tailed black cockatoo. And I mean, they don't come near the house, but you can hear them from miles. You don't want that Sunshine Coast thing where you have 100 lorikeets sitting on the railing. We want a couple on the feeders, have feed, fly off. Somebody else comes in, has a feed, flies off. And you will see hierarchy. The lorikeets will hunt probably everything they'll win. The magpies every now and come in and hunt everything off the feeders and have a bit of a feed and then go, and everybody comes back. So it turns over.
In a small suburban garden, what sort of trees would people plant to create habitat for birds?
Lily pillies, I would think, would be the best. There will be plenty of garden experts that will have other ideas, but lily pilly doesn't get out of hand. It is prunable, so you can keep it to a certain size. As you can see, several of those in a clump is lovely habitat.
A wonderful part of the garden is this east-facing bank. It provides very good drainage for all sorts of gems, things like this grafted Grevillea formosa, big spectacular flowers that attracts things like the eastern spinebills. Now you'll notice the very informal and dense planting here, and that's a great tip as far as maintenance goes. There's no room for weeds to grow whatsoever. and the whole thing is beautifully framed by those spectacular native hibiscus.
The whole of our exercise here has been a learning curve, and we're still learning about looking after the bush and how to maintain it and encourage it. But once you start understanding those principles, then you see what to do. And I think Australians now are becoming aware of the importance of that. If we want to save our native flora and fauna, we've got to do something about it.